So here's a weird stat for you. Despite the inability for Formula One to really truly crack the US market, the United States has had more racing venues for a Formula One Grand Prix than any other country on Earth. And it's also the only nation to hold three Grand Prix in the same country in one season. Now these are the facts and stats that you sign up for when you subscribe to the channel. And the reason I want to do this video in particular is because it's been kicked off by some memes on Twitter. Which sounds weird, I know, but hear me out here. If you know me and the channel, you'll know that I do sim racing and esports as well as, you know, this sort of thing. And I'm racing and streaming tomorrow night, as it so happens, the Indy Grand Prix in the VOR IndyCar League. And in the last 24 hours or so, iRacing announced that they're working on a US track currently used in Formula One, which probably means Miami or Las Vegas, but the memes were Dallas or Detroit. Or as I wrote in response to that, Phoenix, which is the US-based track that you might not have heard of or have completely forgotten about. So let's figure out how the hell this town in Arizona became the venue of a Formula One Grand Prix. The first F1 race ever held in the United States was back in 1959, when the series visited Sebring in Florida. This is on a layout a little different to how it is now, but it's the race where Jack Brabham secured the first of his three world championships, and it's where Bruce McLaren became the then youngest F1 winner. It's also the place where two extra funny stories happened, which I covered in a dedicated video for this particular race, but I'll recap the stories here because they're funny and interesting. The first story is that Brabham and McLaren were in a hotel the night before practice, and Roger Ward, the then USAC national champion, approached them and talked to them. Brabham asked him if he was going to be in the race, to which Ward said yes. He was being paid to enter by the organisers of the Grand Prix and was bringing his midget car, with Ward claiming that his midget car would blow the F1 cars away in the corners because, in his own words, the midget takes corners better than any European sports car. Story goes that Brabham and McLaren waited for Ward to leave the pit lane and then decided to play with him. They waited for him to get towards turn one, whereupon they left the pit lane and their two Euro poor sports cars absolutely blitzed the midget car through turn one and buggered off into the distance. Ward was 43 seconds off Moss's pole time. The second part of this story is the ghost lap. Harry Schell had cut out part of the course to get himself into third, after his previous time had only been good enough for 11th. Nobody at the time knew how it happened, but protests were being filed left, right and centre while the national anthem was being sung, but it was all accepted and Schell was allowed to start third. He'd used an access road to shave 6 seconds off his lap, much to everybody's annoyance, but he retired after 6 laps, so it was all for nothing really. Still, there are a couple of funny stories that I at least find interesting and funny, but the race at Sebring only lasted for 1 year. For 1960, it was going to move to Riverside. Stirling Moss in his Lotus blew everybody away in that race, and it allowed for a lot of American USAC oval racers and sports car racers to get onto the grid, which would have been good for American racing stars to see how they fared against the best from Europe, with utterly massive prize purses on offer. Unfortunately, despite being a track that the Americans seem to have a lot of nostalgia for, with it later being the track that Ken Miles was killed at and is now sadly a shopping centre or industrial park or something like that, the Grand Prix was not well promoted and didn't get that many attendees. On top of this, the sports car race at the track was way more popular, so F1 needed a new home. And then it found it, the small town of Watkins Glen in upstate New York. Steamed hams on the barbecue and all that good stuff. And if you've never heard the term, it's more of an Albany expression than in, say, Utica. Located in the Finger Lakes area of the state, it was the perfect end of season getaway. Scenic, especially in autumn, and if the championship was already wrapped up and they were just racing for pride or whatever scraps of positions in the table that were left, it was always a massive party. There's a clip from way back in the day of all the drivers partying while Francois Sever plays the piano for them, and it was just one of those things that was very of the time. So back then it was cigarettes and drinking and women, now it's energy drink and grill the grid. Times really have changed, haven't they? The track became incredibly well loved. It was like Brands Hatch in a way, except you could actually race on it. It won the Best Organised Grand Prix award several times, and in 1961 it was the best attended of the three F1 Grand Prix in the States so far. 60,000 people through the gates, and it turned a profit for the organisers. It has to be said at this point that prior to settling on the Glen, the France family had been contacted about using Daytona, and a street race in Miami was also on the cards, but these never happened. Because of its place right at the end of the season, where, as already mentioned, championships might already be sewn up with the best of X races counting, there needed to be an incentive to actually race, and the prize purses were even bigger than they were at Riverside. In 1969, the winner got $50,000. In 1972, it had gone up to $100,000. But with it came safety concerns as the cars evolved, and it was soon clear that as time went on, the cars were outgrowing the track, much like they were at others. Francois Sever was killed in 1973, Helmut Koenig killed in 1974, and rowdy fans would go into a part of the track called the Bog just to set fire to stuff. A Greyhound bus was torched in 1974. The Bog was turned into a car park, but this didn't help much. The track itself was falling apart, and Fieser made demands to upgrade. The circuit did, but it put it into debt. With no financial help or bailouts from the state of New York, the race that had been scheduled to go onto the calendar for 1981 never happened, and instead, it moved to a car park, of all places. No, a literal car park. I should also mention here, because somebody is going to tell me that I forgot, that between 1976 and 1983 there was a second race in the US, called the US GP West at Long Beach in California. Because if you don't geography much, the US is massive. But as already pointed out, this didn't have the US GP moniker, much like the race in the car park didn't. That was simply called the Caesars Palace Grand Prix, which also has its own dedicated video. Now if you want to watch that video you can, but the long and short of it is, the race at Caesars Palace was a shit show. But that wasn't going to stop Formula One getting something on in the US. Two more street circuits were added to the calendar after the demise of the races in Nevada and California. One on the streets of Detroit, which kind of became the home of F1 in America for a time, and a race on the streets of Dallas in Texas, during which Mansell pushed his Lotus over the line in the searing heat and then passed out. F1, in its infinite wisdom, had held that race in July, and the temperature in Dallas that day was 104 Fahrenheit, 40 degrees Celsius, and because of the cars of the time, they were destroying the road surface. Detroit would remain the home of Formula One in the United States until 1988, when that was eventually canned. Basically, it was getting expensive. Detroit was being used for both Formula One and IndyCar, and Bernie Eccleston had told the organisers of the race that if they wanted to keep the race, they had to pay $3 million and build a permanent pit facility, both of which the organisers of the Grand Prix were unwilling to do. CART, meanwhile, was charging just $600,000 without the need for the pit facilities. So F1 needed to go somewhere else. Enter businessman Guy Gonyea. I don't know how to pronounce it, I'm sorry. Gonyea approached the mayor of Phoenix in Arizona, Terry Goddard, about hosting a Grand Prix on the streets of the city. The initial discussion had happened in 1986 to improve the reputation of the city as a tourist destination. At a meeting of the city's officials, a feasibility study was conducted that got the approval of 37 of the city's leading business officials, and also got the approval of local congressman John Kill. With everything in place and the backing of the city's top suits, the proposal was then taken to Paris to meet with the FIA and Bernie to see what could be done. A second meeting was organised in 1987, but with Detroit having a contract until 1991, the possibility of Phoenix getting onto the calendar was slim, because Formula One already had a home, as it were, for the time being, in Motor City of all places. But with Detroit unwilling to bow to the hosting fees and the facility improvement demands, and holding an IndyCar race there in 1989, it meant that the opening was there for Phoenix to host after all. The city council voted to spend $9 million worth of taxpayers' money on this race, and despite Arizona also being blisteringly hot in the summer, it inherited Detroit's spot on the calendar, so the race was going to be held in July, and they also only had 4 months to get everything ready. The result was a track that might just be one of the most unimaginative layouts in history, not helped by the United States using the grid system to plan out its cities. Now, I will concede that the grid system is utterly brilliant for navigating cities, but for designing a street circuit, it's not particularly good. The cars started, as they often do, at the start line and sped towards turns 1, 2 and 3, which formed a chicane at the intersection of West Jefferson Street and North First. Most of the streets used to make this track were named after early US presidents. It was then up through the long turn 4, which isn't really a turn, up to turn 5, that saw them go up North 5th and then left at turn 6 to go south on North 3rd. Turn 8 took them east along West Washington up to a bus stop shaped section of 9, 10, 11 and 12, before heading through 13, 14 and 15 to get back onto the start finish straight. 13, 14 and 15 almost like a tighter version of the ending section of Singapore, come to think of it. But it was really uninspiring. The track surface was about as smooth as a snooker table and it had no elevation change whatsoever. Not that elevation change is needed to have a good track, because Silverstone and Monza exist, but still, it was in the middle of a city that wasn't really offering anything, really.
So then what I thought I'd do at this point of the video is do a little bit of show and tell, show you the layout of the track, show you what was going on, because most of you watching might not know the layout of Phoenix, or some of you might not have known that it existed up until you clicked on this video. So, in Martin Brundle's Brabham here, I'm just going to pull out of the pit lane, very slowly and carefully, because I've never driven a 1989 car before, and straight out onto the start finish straight. Incredibly flat, incredibly wide, up towards turn one here, get on the brakes, slowly down the gears. I'm only doing like a cautious outlap here just to show you. So that's turn one. The only bumps really going to be on the manhole covers dotted around the track. Turn two, turn three here, turn four now. Oof. It's tighter than it looked. Up through the kink. And as you can see, pretty much every corner is a 90 degree left or a 90 degree right. Heel and toeing down through the gears. That's another left here. I'm a little bit lost. Been a long time since I've driven this track. The only elevation change you'll find, but because it's going through this underpass, through another 90 degree corner, past Woolies, then same old as we go around this building. At least the traffic lights tell you where to go. Into the final section here. Just exiting the bus stoppy type bit. And then to the bit that I said looks like the ending part of Singapore. You can probably see what I'm talking about with that. Let's give it some beans. Try and avoid the bumps in the manholes there. With a chicane. I call it a chicane, but it's not really a chicane, is it? It's an abomination. Thought I'd overcook that slightly. But as you can see, it's not an inspiring layout at all. It's just 90 degree corners. Really hard to get your bearings, really hard to get your braking points. And smoother than a snooker table. Just dull. Baku is more fun than this. Singapore is more fun than this. At the minute, I'm more interested in what Iceberg makes than I am the track. This is horrendous. Like, utterly horrendous. I'll do a couple of time lapse here, just to see what I can do. Into the Singapore final section. And here comes the spotter. I'll turn this bit down.
That was a 139.94.
Didn't ask. I can't imagine that the drivers enjoyed this either. Especially in 1989 when it was so blisteringly hot. 104 degrees Fahrenheit, so 40 degrees Celsius. Must have been trying to kill them.
That was a 137.97.
I don't know how good that is, but I'm done. Right, let's get out of here. I hate this. That was so boring.
So as you can imagine, the heat really took its toll on the drivers and the cars. Senna had taken pole in his McLaren, but the electrics fried just over half distance. Just 6 of the 26 cars on the grid made it to the end of the Grand Prix. Prost ahead of Patrese, with Eddie Cheever in third, which should have been a popular result given that he was an American driver, from Phoenix no less. But attendances weren't particularly great. Not only were the attendances low due to not being able to squeeze in enough temporary grandstands, but the problem was those grandstands didn't offer much of a view beyond what they were looking at. At least at Monaco, the grandstand at the swimming pool can see a wide view. The small grandstand at the chicane looks towards the back. Standing on a balcony offers a decent round view of the circuit, and so on. But there were stadiums in Division 3 football in England that had more people inside. The record-breaking attendance for the BTCC is higher than what attended a Formula 1 Grand Prix in Phoenix. 1990 is the only race of note that happened at this track. This was the year that Jean Alesi, in a Tyrrell that had no sponsors on it and unfavoured Pirelli tyres, finished second to Senna's superior McLaren, and led for a good chunk of the race too. The date of the race was shifted to be the season opener in March to try and get away from the scorching heat, and also a Minardi started on the front row for this race, thanks to the Pirellis being so good at these sorts of tracks. But for 1991 though, the layout changed slightly. Instead of the chicane at North first, the track turned right and then a left onto the next block on East Jackson, with turn 4 taking you into what I remember being some sort of park or wasteland or something, where a hairpin would loop you back round. This is the layout I remember from the original Jeff Crammond Grand Prix game, and Ted Meat did a recent video where he tried to qualify some canal boat of a minnow around here. I think he might have done that for 1990 though on the older layout, but still, it's an interesting watch. I'll leave a link in the description if I remember. Part of the reason for the redesign was because the fire station that had been at the end of the start-finish straight was going to be moved, and the Phoenix Suns or some other basketball team were getting a new basketball arena, so they had to adapt things a bit. But this didn't do much for attendances, and this is the bit that's the kicker for the Grand Prix. What if I was to tell you that there was an annual ostrich racing contest in the city that drew a bigger crowd? People riding ostriches like horses, drawing a bigger audience than Ayrton Senna. Someone on Reddit who had been to both said that the ostrich racing was more interesting, and there's also an unconfirmed story that Nigel Roebuck had got into a cab at the airport and asked the driver to take him to the racetrack, where he ended up at this ostrich race. Capacity for the Grand Prix was around 40,000, but they barely achieved half of that, so it was kind of around sort of 19,000 to 21,000 per race. So it really does come to something when ostrich racing is more popular than the world's most popular motorsport. This shows how little the people of Phoenix cared for this Grand Prix. And because the first race had been held in June, where the temperatures are about 104 degrees and nobody is found outside in those temperatures, that didn't help things. 6 cars finished that race, and there's reports of arrogance from the organisers too. With little in the way of capacity, little in the way of interest to start with, the hot temperatures of July in the desert, 6 cars finishing, and $9 million of people's money spent on it when they probably weren't interested to start with, then the event was seen as being a joke from the very outset. The Reddit user Phil McCracken 2, the second of the noble McCracken clan, said that the circuit sucked. Think a rougher Baku without the castle section. It was as hot as the surface of the sun, and Americans don't really care much for international sports. Detroit was better to race and as a spectacle, and that was lousy too. Dallas was a little better for racing, but that was even hotter than Phoenix. We don't talk about Vegas. The 80s was a decade of mediocrity when it comes to Formula 1 in the USA. After the 1991 edition, which Senna would also win, Bernie sent a fax to the organisers from his office in London to say that Phoenix would not be on the calendar anymore, and paid the cancellation fees in the contract. Formula 1 would abandon the United States in favour of a return to South Africa, which was seen as being a big move given that apartheid had just ended in the country and the boycotts of the country were now ending. When asked if the low attendances were the reason for the cancellation, Bernie said it wasn't, but more to do with the fact that those who went couldn't see more than the small piece of track that they occupied. Formula 1 would go off the calendar until 2000, when Bernie did a deal with Tony George of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway to hold races there, and I think that the first race at Indy is the most attended Grand Prix ever in terms of the Sunday attendance. Unfortunately, following the events of Michelin Gate in 2005, the Grand Prix at Indy dropped off in terms of popularity, and it was canned at the end of 2007, before returning to the schedule in 2012 with the Circuit of the Americas in Austin. Today, Formula One has three races a year in the States, as the new owners in Liberty Media seek to try and get some sort of foothold in the country that has its motorsport roots with IndyCar and NASCAR. One race at COTA, one at Miami near the Miami Dolphins football stadium, and one on the streets of Las Vegas. The latter two races have come under criticism, with Miami being dubbed another standard issue cookie cutter temporary circuit, and the Las Vegas race being criticised for being a race that the city didn't particularly want. The blocking out of bridges over the strip, non-casino businesses losing revenue due to the building of the track, and other concerns. Oh, and the hotel room prices, as well as Formula One funding the race to get it on the calendar, while classic tracks like Spa, Silverstone, Hockenheim and so on get nothing in the way of hosting fee breaks. It seems there's not that much that remains of the track in the city. There is a mural of Senna painted on Central Avenue, but that's about it. Watkins Glen had F1 history. Indy as a whole is a mecca for motorsport fans. Sebring has its endurance heritage. Detroit was in Motor City and still has Indy races today, as does Long Beach. Riverside has history too for sports cars, and Dallas only hosted one race, so could be forgiven for being forgotten. But Phoenix seems to be the one that is truly lost. Nobody would have a go at you for forgetting that it did actually host three races, but nobody remembers any of them apart from what a lazy did in 1991. So then, a look at how Formula One came to race on the streets of Phoenix, Arizona, and how it was so unpopular that ostrich racing was more popular. If this has taught you something new, then do like the video so I know a good job was done. And for more stuff like this from the motorsport history books, get subscribed and also get that bell on so you never miss out on anything else I do around here. Massive thanks, as ever, go out to the rad lads at Patreon that support at a more personal level. And if you want to help keep things running around here, then a link to Patreon is in the description, along with links to Discord, socials, and other bits and pieces you might want or need to know. There is some stuff on the F1 store right now, if you're interested, as we lead up towards the Dutch Grand Prix. There's also super thanks for one and done donations, like buy me a coffee or a cold drink, and there's memberships there too if you just want to support in a method that's not Patreon. So until next time, I've been Adam Millward, have a great day wherever you are, and goodbye.